Dear Great Assembly, please join your hands to recite the Buddha's name for blessings.
Nam mô Phật Bổn Sư Thích Ca Mâu Ni. Nam mô Phật Bổn Sư Thích Ca Mâu Ni. Nam mô Phật Bổn Sư Thích Ca Mâu Ni. Nam mô Phật Bổn Sư Thích Ca Mâu Ni.
Kính thưa Dear Great Assembly,
Phật tử cùng đại chúng.
Today is the 20th day of the third month in the year of the rat. The 12th of April 2020. The whole world is struggling against the COVID-19 pandemic. A lot of loss, suffering, and mourning have enveloped humanity. Our country, Vietnam, is implementing nationwide social distancing to prevent the COVID-19. In such a painful situation, as the Buddha's disciples, we can't avoid thoughts and emotions.
Những cái suy tư, những các cái xúc cảm. Dù là ai,
whoever on this earth passes away,
mà ra đi,
is a big loss for his family and relatives.
Với gia đình, với người thân.
It is the same for us. We are all humans who live together on this earth with humanity.
Chúng ta có cái tình người.
As a Buddhist monk,
với tư cách là một tu sĩ Phật giáo, cũng vậy,
I'm very moved by such a tragedy.
Đồng tâm trước một cái thảm cảnh như thế này. Và
and I have vowed
cái tâm nguyện của thầy
to bring the best and the most beneficial things
tốt đẹp nhất, lợi ích nhất từ
from the Buddha Dharma to all Buddhists as well as to everyone,
cũng như tất cả mọi người,
so that everyone can benefit from the Dharma. So, since the beginning of the coronavirus outbreak, I have encouraged all the Buddhists of Ba Vang Pagoda comply with the instructions of state and health agencies in the prevention of COVID-19.
Cơ quan y tế trong việc phòng chống dịch COVID-19
and practice the Dharma at home, praying, chanting sutras, dedicating merit in the hope that the coronavirus pandemic will be stamped out soon. Right from the second day of the first month of the Lunar New Year, Ba Vang Pagoda has already encouraged all the Buddhists to practice the Dharma, dedicate merit, and pray for an end of this epidemic. Because it's been 3 months since the second of the first lunar month, I'm afraid that you may become distracted from your practice or lose your faith over such a long time. So today, I am having a Dharma talk to share the Buddha Dharma with the aim of encouraging you to practice diligently and helping you consolidate the faith in three jewels so that you can truly get benefits from the three jewels. We also dedicate beneficial merit to everyone
đến với tất cả mọi người.
Who are our sisters and brothers living on the same earth so that they can also benefit from this. So today, I have this talk. And the topic of today's talk is praying and chanting Ratana Sutra with complete faith to overcome the COVID-19 pandemic. That is the topic I want to share with you today. I hope you will listen carefully, learn and understand the Dharma, to have full belief in the three jewels, and to receive the protection from the three jewels. Then we can spread that energy to everyone, to our relatives, to our community, and more broadly, to all of humanity who are struggling against this COVID-19 pandemic. Now let's get to the point. Dear Great Assembly, for the topic, praying and chanting Ratana Sutra with complete faith to overcome the COVID-19 pandemic, I'd like to divide it into some issues to share with you. Firstly, I will talk about the causes and conditions of the COVID-19 pandemic.
Nó là nhân duyên thế nào?
The second is about prayer. Does prayer bring any benefit?
Có lợi ích không?
Why do we pray? And if yes, how should we pray to get benefits? The third is about Paritta Sutras, also called the Sutra of Protection, which includes Ratana Sutra that we are practicing and reciting. What is the power of Paritta Sutras? How should the faith of practitioners be to receive the protection of the sutra? Those are the three main issues we will discuss today. Dear Great Assembly, as for the causes and conditions of the COVID-19 pandemic, I want to say that we should assert, in the view of a Buddha's disciple, COVID-19 is the retribution of humanity. This is the karma of humanity. We need to make it clear this way. Nothing can be outside the law of cause and effect, karma. The pandemic happens to humans, so we know this is our karma. The law of cause and effect really exists. We cannot deny it. COVID-19 is actually caused by the SARS-CoV-2 virus. The coronavirus has been spreading almost worldwide, with more than 200 countries reporting confirmed cases. Hundreds of thousands of people have died of the coronavirus. First found in Wuhan, China, the virus has spread to many other countries, and now the United States is the leading country in the number of confirmed cases and deaths, exceeding Italy. That's such a terrible and mournful situation. And the whole world is now struggling to prevent this pandemic. Fear has overwhelmed the whole world. Firstly, As Buddhists, we know certainly this is our karma, the karma of humanity. So what bad karma have we created in recent decades? Dear Great Assembly, I would like to mention some evil karma, maybe not all. The first is the karma of killing and harming beings. This karma of humanity in recent decades has been so terrible. The karma of killing and eating living beings. Has been so terrible. Think about meat processing plants. You may have watched many videos about the meat processing plants. They kill animals very horribly and painfully on a mass scale. Animals are killed miserably. So miserably. You know what is the result of this karma? Killing is taking life. So the retribution of our life will be harmed. How will our life be harmed? Our lifespan will be reduced. And our health will deteriorate. It is due to the evil of killing. What else does killing cause? It makes animals suffer. A bird has its nest, and a fish has its school. As for birds, now if the parents are caught, their children will be orphaned, right? The same for fish. If we catch the parents, baby fishes will not know where their parents are and where to shelter. Then their school will be split asunder. This killing karma is so severe. So how does it affect humans currently? The retribution is we lose our lives and our health becomes weaker. It is so grievous. Do you see? We have to be apart from each other. Wives have to be apart with their husbands. Children have to part with their parents. More painfully, we can't even see each other in the last moments. We all want to see the faces of our beloved when they die. But now, in this COVID-19 pandemic, we can't even do it. The coronavirus patients who die in the hospital will be tidily wrapped and numbered outside. No one sees their faces anymore. Then the corpses will be brought by a hearse to the crematorium or buried in mass graves. Their relatives are not allowed to get close to them. Do you feel heartbroken? They are our fathers, our mothers, our husbands, or our children. But if in the last moment we cannot see their faces or say anything to them, is it heartbreaking? Only when we are in that dreadful situation do we remember the beings we caught, separated from their herds, and killed. Their offspring also didn't know when they died, did they? They had no idea. We split their herd. And now we suffer the same situation as retribution. It's the truth. It is very cruel that we destroy nests to catch birds and their babies. Therefore, we are suffering the same situation now. This let us know that once there's a cause, there are its effects. The law of karma isn't unfair to us, dear Great Assembly. So the first karma is that of killing, which is also the most painful retribution we have to pay now, dear Great Assembly. In terms of the law of cause and effect, we recognize this karma. The second evil karma is that we destroy the environment. Deep drilling into the earth and the ocean floor, deforestation, and so on. So many things we have done that destroyed nature without any regret. Riverbeds, seabeds, lakes, and so on. We destroy anywhere we want. That is evil karma. And what else? We have irresponsibly dumped a lot of toxic substances into the environment. It is so selfish of us to dump toxins into the environment inconsiderately. For the sake of ourselves, our companies or factories, those actions pollute rivers, sea and air severely, dear Great Assembly. So in recent years, we have seen constant mass fish deaths in the sea. Ozone holes, greenhouse effect, forest fires, storms, flash floods, earthquakes and tsunami. Sometimes we drill and exploit so much oil at a place that creates underground hollows because of land subsidence. Oil flows underground from places to places. If we overexploit oil at one place, the ground of other places will become hollow. Consequently, the land there will subside. That seabed is dropped can cause tsunamis. It is the seed we sow and the result we have to get. And the contaminated environment also breeds viruses. We are to blame for this. The second evil karma is that humanity is destroying the environment. What else? In recent years, when information technology and social networking have developed dramatically, our karma of gossiping has increased. Frankly, it is our karma of the mouth. There are so much gossip, calumny, and making things up. These happen a lot. When face to face, we may be nice to each other. Behind another's back, we can have evil tongue, evil words, and insult each other in many ways. We have done all kinds of underhand tricks. You see, that's the fact of humankind in recent years. People are always ready to slander, insult, and disparage anybody who posts anything on social media in an underhand way. This happens a lot. Dishonesty, stretching the truth, outrageous headlines, and many things like that. You see, though the karma of slander may not be represented verbally, but just through words we post on the internet, they all belong to the karma of the mouth. Now that we get the retribution, you see? Now we have to cover our mouths. That is the retribution. Because I am preaching online today, I'm not wearing a mask. In recent days, we have to wear a face mask which covers the mouth. Because we have created excessive and severe karma of our mouths. As we hide our faces and harm others, now we have to cover our faces. We even have to cover all our bodies with medical protective clothing. so no one see our faces. A father cannot see his child's face. A wife cannot see her husband's face. We cannot see each other because we create the karma of harming others behind their back. So now we have to cover ourselves from top to toe. We cannot recognize each other. We have to cover almost everything when going out. That is the karma of the mouth. The karma of slander that humanity has created. So complicated. You see, now we have to wear a face mask when talking to each other. Indeed, without a face mask, it is very dangerous to talk to each other now. We don't dare to sit opposite to each other to talk either. Saliva spitting is dangerous. So which karma leads to this? It definitely comes from the karma of our mouths. Nonetheless, we share this karma with everyone. As living on the same planet, all of humanity must share karma together. Much or little, we also have this karma, so we must share it. So we had to wear a face mask and cover our faces. Do you see? Just reflect on yourself. Is there anyone who doesn't have the karma of the mouth? Since learning the Buddha Dharma, we may have transformed this bad karma a little bit, just a little bit, not completely. We have done a lot of things, namely cheating, lying, slandering, harming others, and fabricating stories about others. So we have to cover our faces and mouths now. Just a tiny virus can make all of us cover our mouths. The whole of humanity has to cover the mouths, dear Great Assembly. This is such subtle and strange retribution. Who can ask the Prime Minister or the President to cover their mouths? Just the coronavirus can. Everyone has to cover their mouths and wear masks. Do you see that? That is our evil karma, resulting from gossip and evil speech. So now we have to suffer our own karmic retribution. Then what else? In the past decades, economics and society have been significantly developing. So has the civilization. As a result, people have run after the life of desire and indulgence, fame and money. Scenes of debauchery and dissipation have taken place everywhere. Debauchery took place everywhere. And people can be so cruel just to satisfy their debauchery. For example, some people even eat fresh monkey brains. They put the monkey in a cage and let its head stick up out of the cage. Then they cut open its skull and spoon the fresh brain to eat. They eat it alive. An alive fish is cut on its back and then put in the pan to be fried while it is still alive. Then they eat it. Dear Great Assembly, that's what some people did. So we call it dissipation in a cruel way. A lot of debauchery and dissipation. That is bad karma. The development of civilization involves a lot of shameful conduct of humans. So, the coronavirus has warned us as a response. Now, all those activities have to be stopped. Entertainment centers now have to be temporarily closed. It's dangerous to come there. It is a warning. Do you see? many good traditional values over the years are taken for granted. Humanity, morality, and family love are taken for granted and ignored. We take ethical and human values lightly. In contrast, we overvalue fame, money, material wealth, and enjoyment of sensual pleasures. Now we have to pay the price. Everyone has to stay at home and go nowhere. Places of amusement are now to be closed. Do you see? It is also the karma that responds to us. The coronavirus can do these things. We have overvalued sensual pleasures. And we forget so many good values. Now we are paying the price. Dear Great Assembly, there is one more karma that can be seen from a Buddhist point of view. The karma of damaging and destroying the true Dharma, the Buddha's realization of the truth, the monasteries of monks and their practices to liberation. This sort of karma breeds very bad retribution. Dear Great Assembly, we know that these are the basic causes. And the bad karma created by humanity, which manifest themselves in the coronavirus. In Buddhism, we often say that karma manifests itself one after another. Humankind is the owner of karma. Our living situation, including the coronavirus, is the result of the owner. The owner's result depends on the karma's owner to manifest itself in many ways. So, the coronavirus is not beyond our karma. It is because of our karma that gives rise to the virus. You see, if there is still our bad karma, there will be this virus. The virus mutates quickly in a subtle way. And this is a fact that has been happening. It mutates because mankind is still having this sort of bad karma. Once the bad karma has not been transformed, the virus will keep mutating. Even when the coronavirus vaccine is available, the virus will keep mutating, and we will have to struggle to develop a new vaccine. Developing a vaccine is difficult. They say it may take years to find a vaccine to prevent this virus. If we come out with a new vaccine, the virus will be mutating into various strains. So again, we will have to struggle to develop another vaccine. Moreover, the infected person doesn't know if he is infected with the old or the new virus. So it might think he has to be injected with both the new and the old vaccine. It is very miserable. I myself find it so miserable. So what can really end this virus is that the whole of humanity has to transform our bad karma. That is the Buddhist view on the law of cause and effect. We understand and surely believe so. Mankind has to transform this bad karma. When all bad karma is transformed, there will not be the virus. Without karma transformation, there will still be the virus. The remaining effects of the virus depends on how we transform our karma. The more people in many regions transform their karma, the less the impact of the virus will be. But when the bad karma remains, the virus is still inherent in us. Whose karma is severe, we still have to face and struggle with the virus. Dear Great Assembly, now, how can we defeat this virus? We have to transform our karma. We are the karma owner. If we transform our karma, the virus will disappear itself. The virus was also born due to us. Mankind has been undergoing so many pandemics, one pandemic starts after another. When a kind of virus is killed, another kind of it appears. It is because of our remaining evil karma. Once evil karma is still pursuing us, pandemics will appear. That is about our result. Be clearly aware of that. We can see it clearly. So the first idea you should understand is that the COVID-19 pandemic is the retribution of mankind. You should know that. In Buddhist view, we can see and surely believe that. And in order to transform the situation, we have to transform our karma. Karma transformation includes every individual transforms karma, community transforms karma, and mankind transforms karma. If an individual transforms his karma, he will be safe. The same for the whole of humanity. Whoever does not transform their karma can hardly be safe. It is hard for people with this karma if they do not transform their karma. We know that law already. That is the first idea. Second, I'd like to talk about prayer. Ba Vàng Pagoda has organized programs of self-cultivation for lay Buddhists. Praying and chanting sutras since the second day of the first lunar month. It has been nearly 3 months of continual self-cultivation, including chanting the sutras, praying and dedicating the merit. Today, I'm so happy to say that there has not been any Buddhist of Ba Vàng Pagoda testing positive for the COVID-19 yet. This is very good news, and I think that you have been very diligent in your practice. About prayer, you can see the Vietnam Buddhist Sangha also encourages all monks, nuns, and lay Buddhists in the country to hold prayer programs to neutralize and stop the COVID-19 pandemic. Many pagodas pray, many Buddhists pray. In addition, adherents of all religions in the world are now praying. They are all praying. And I think that maybe even atheists also pray for the time being. Not only those who are religious. Atheists also pray because they don't know what to do now. Even if they are atheists, what else can be done? They cannot see the coronavirus and don't know when it will come to them. The virus is so tiny that we cannot see it with our naked eyes. It must be seen with a microscope. But this pandemic gives us the chance to realize that we are truly fragile and small. Is it right? We realize that we are really fragile and small. Not only is the coronavirus small, but also we are fragile and small. We are too small in this vast universe. A tiny virus can kill us, so we realize that we are too fragile and small. We are not strong at all, right? For years, we've been thinking that we are heroes. We are the Lord of all beings. Now, the fact is that we are not. We must obey the coronavirus. If it orders us to cover our mouths, we must cover our mouths. It says no debauchery. We have to stop all our debauchery. Do you see? It tells us to keep our distance. We must stay afar from each other. No more being close. It says we cannot see each other if we die. We must obey. Do you see that? Then we are no lord of all beings. We are no great hero at all. We are really small and insignificant, very small. So we, as humans, should not pat ourselves on the back and regard ourselves as heroes or anything great at all, which we entitle ourselves to deprive other beings of their rights. For years, we've been considering that humans are the Lord. And other beings must serve us. But now we realize that we are not. Humans are very fragile and small. That's a fact. We are too small. Being that insignificant, who can we rely on now when not any vaccine is available? We do not know when the virus will come to us. While we have to breathe, how can we avoid it? So, even people with or without religion should think about prayer. Well, they pray to anyone they could think of, such as the Buddha, gods, saints, devas, or deity. They just pray without knowing who will listen to their prayers. Now all of us have to pray, dear Great Assembly. The whole world prays together. Praying is nothing bad. At least it helps us relieve our worries with the thought that divine forces will listen to our prayer and save us. There is nothing bad in praying, nothing bad. What does prayer mean? It means hope and wish. We send our hopes and wishes to the divine that we trust. We wish them to save, help, and protect us. That is prayer. People of different religions will pray to their religious leaders or their holy forces. People of every religion pray to whom they trust. Today I am talking about the topic, praying in Buddhism. Prayer in Buddhism has existed for thousands of years. It cannot be said that there is no prayer in Buddhism. In Buddhist texts, there are many sutras of prayer. Since we know that we are so weak and fragile, we cannot be completely self-reliant, dear Great Assembly. No one can be self-reliant. Nobody can pat himself on the back for being totally independent. In this Dharma realm of cause and condition, we certainly cannot be completely self-reliant. We were born thanks to our parents. A baby grows up thanks to breast milk and mother nurture. Also, he must rely on a baby walker to practice walking. How can we say that we don't need to take refuge in anything? We all should have a refuge because we know we are so insignificant. So we should pray. In Buddhism, prayer is necessary. It raises our spirits. What's more, once I had talked about how to achieve fulfilled prayers. To have a prayer fulfilled, we must have fully assembled causes and conditions because we live in the Dharma realm of cause and condition. Everything will be accomplished with fully assembled causes and conditions, including prayer. It is not beyond the relation of cause and condition. There are often five conditions that will lead to a fulfilled prayer. The first condition is the content of the prayer. What do we pray? Is the prayer righteous or not? For example, if we pray for good health and longevity, that is a righteous prayer. But if we pray that a person will die or get infected with the virus, we are praying falsely. Such prayer is not righteous. That is evil, not a good prayer. It is not a good condition. It is impossible to fulfill our prayer with an evil mind. Secondly, to whom do we pray? Is he of great or small virtue? The more virtuous and blessed he is, the more likely our prayers will come true. Please remember that we are very lucky to be Buddhists. We are disciples of the Most Supreme One. The Buddha is the King of all kings, the Sage of all sages, and the Lord of all lords. He is the unexcelled. We pray to the Buddha, who possessed full compassion, wisdom, courage, virtues, and blessings. Every aspect of him is perfect. So that is a good cause, a great condition, and blessing of all monks, nuns, and Buddhists. That was the answer to whom we pray. In other religions, we pray to their leaders. We don't know how their leaders are. In some religions, they pray to a stone elephant, a stone horse, a stone dog, a god of banyan tree, and many others. However, Buddhists only pray to the Buddha, to the three jewels, bodhisattvas, holy monks, devas, fortune saints, and Dharma protectors. They are the ones to whom we pray. What is the third condition? Do we pray with the most sincere and earnest mind, or in a perfunctory way? People say that a sincere and wholehearted prayer is more likely to be accomplished. In contrast, if we just pray by joining hands, taking some bows, and saying some words, it will not help. It creates no power. Dear Great Assembly, praying that way is like a phone running out of battery, which can't get a signal. Like a radio with an empty battery, which can't be turned on. You shouldn't pray like that. You must pray with determination. It means you must pray with an earnest mind. It is called the earnest prayer. What is the fourth condition? It is whether we vow to practice to transform our bad karma or not. If we pray to supreme beings, but we keep our bad habits and selfishness, who can support us? Until we keep our bad habits without any vow to correct them, even the Buddha cannot help us. Do you understand? For example, our child asks for money, but we know that he is a debauchee. We will never give him money, won't we? Only when we see that he becomes industrious, he does what he promised, and vows to correct his character honestly, shall we give him money to do business? But if we know that he is all talk and no action, we will not give him any money at all. Even ordinary people like us understand that. If our child just makes empty promises, no way shall we give him money, which spoils him more. The supreme beings understand that even more profoundly. So when it comes to prayer and vow, we must sincerely pray and vow to practice to transform our evil minds, our bad karma, and our bad habits, then we will be responded and supported. In other words, that is when our prayers are accepted. And the fifth condition is that we must have reserved blessing. Those who have accumulated a lot of blessings and good karma are likely to have their prayer accomplished. If you have too much evil karma, your prayer will hardly be accomplished. But if you have accumulated merit and good karma for many years, your prayer will likely come true. Even if you are not good at praying, but because of your accumulated blessings, your prayer will be accomplished. In my Dharma talk of fulfillment of prayer, I explain these causes and conditions with more details. And we see that prayer works if there are enough causes and conditions. We can't deny prayer as some people do. Some people say that Buddhism doesn't advocate prayer. That's absolutely not true. Even Bodhisattva Samantabhadra also made 10 vows. Many Bodhisattvas also have to pray to the Buddha to be enlightened because their wisdom hasn't been full yet. They must take refuge in the wisdom of the Buddha. They pray for his enlightenment so that they can develop their wisdom. Also, when Ananda was in trouble without the Buddha, he would have destroyed the essence of the precepts. It was thanks to the protection of the Buddha's power. I've just talked about prayer so that you adamantly believe that any prayer with full causes and conditions will have an effect. I haven't said whether the effect is great or little, but it certainly works. Great or little effect depends on your conditions. That is the second point. Now the third point is the protective power of Paritta Sutras and faith of practitioners. Dear Great Assembly, Paritta Sutras belong to the system of Buddhist sutras that features the protective power to chanters. In the Pali Canon, there are about 30 sutras that possess the power to protect practitioners. Eleven of them are very common sutras. I would like to list some of them as follows. Mangala Sutra, Ratana Sutra, also called the Jewel's Discourse, which our pagoda currently chants. The third one is Metta Sutra. The fourth one is Khanda Sutra. The fifth one is Mora Sutra. The sixth one is Vata Sutra. The seventh one is Dajaga Sutra. The eighth is Atanatiya Sutra. And the ninth one is Angulimala Sutra about Angulimala. Do you remember the story of Angulimala, who was saved by the Buddha and then became a monk? One day, when going on alms round, he met a woman who was in labor on the roadside. She was writhing in agony and unable to give birth. He felt pity for her so much. He didn't know what giving birth was like. Seeing her crying, he ran back to the Buddha and told him, "I feel so sorry for her." The Buddha taught Angulimala to tell the woman, "Since the day I was born, I have never killed any beings. These are my sincere words. With my sincerity, I pray that you can give birth easily." After hearing the teaching, Angulimala was startled and said, "It was me who killed 999 people. Why did you say that? I daren't to say it." So the Buddha replied, "Now you are a bhikshu, aren't you? So it is not wrong to say that. Since you were born in the Buddha Dharma, you have never killed any sentient being. Is this the truth?" Then Angulimala realized, "It's right. Since I became a monk, I've started a new life. My previous life ended. It was over." Feeling reassured, Angulimala ran to the woman and said, "Since the day I was born, I have never killed any beings. These are my sincere words. With my sincerity, I pray that you can give birth easily. Right after Angulimala's prayer, the woman gave birth very easily, and the baby was born safely. So Angulimala Sutra is the Sutra of Protection. The 10th Sutra is Bodhyanga Sutra, and the 11th one is Pubana Sutra. In Theravada Buddhism, people often chant these 11 sutras called the Paritta Sutras, which features the ability to provide protection and blessings. Our pagoda often chants Ratana Sutra. Up to now, continuously for nearly 3 months, all the monks, nuns, and Buddhists of Bavang Pagoda have been chanting Ratana Sutra. Dear Great Assembly, Ratana Sutra is also known as the Jewel's Discourse. Why did I encourage you to chant the sutra during the COVID-19 pandemic? Because this sutra was first chanted in an epidemic in Vesali, which caused countless deaths, drought, and famine. Then the generals and leaders of Vesali begged the Buddha and his Sangha for help. They invited the Buddha and the Sangha to their country. Upon his arrival, the Buddha assigned Ananda and 500 bhikkhus to walk around the city of Vesali 3 times, reciting Ratana Sutra. Afterwards, due to the power of the sutra, there came torrential rains, ending the drought and sweeping away the deadly air. The environment was purified. 1 week later, the pandemic ended. Due to this coincidence, I have decided to encourage the community of the pagoda to chant Ratana Sutra to pray for a soon eradication of the pandemic. That is the cause and condition. What is the power of reciting Ratana Sutra? Today, I would like to quote excerpts from Milindapana Sutra explaining the power of reciting Paritta Sutras. In that discourse, King Milinda raised a question to Bhikshu Nagasena. What was his question? He said that, I heard the Buddha said that those who recite the Parittas will escape from the snare of death. King Milinda wondered if it was true or not, whereas the Buddha said that no one could escape from the snare of death and everyone would die. That's right, everyone will die. But the Buddha said that those who recite the Parittas would escape from the snare of death. So he questioned Bhikshu Nagasena. Bhikshu Nagasena said, O King, it is right. The Paritta means the sutras of protection. It is protection to those who have faith and some remaining portion of their life. So, the Paritta can prevent premature death. It is not true that the Parittas have the power to protect those who have no faith and whose lifespan has come to an end. Bhikshu Nagasena answered King Milinda very clearly. The Buddha never said anything wrong. Paritta Sutras can protect those who recite, but they must recite with faith and practice. It is not true that the Parittas can protect those who don't have faith and practice. Especially, their lifespan must still last. What does lifespan mean? I would like to explain so that you will understand the word lifespan. Lifespan means the length of time for which we exist. That's called lifespan. On Earth, lifespan varies among species and breeds. For example, now, the average human lifespan is about 70 years. In Vietnam, it was 65 years in the last few years, but now it is over 70 years. Each country has its own lifespan, but the average lifespan in the world is about 70 years. For instance, the average lifespan of a dog is only 15 years, and other animals also have their own lifespan. Each species has a different lifespan, and so do plants. The lifespan of rice plants only lasts 3 months, while short-lived varieties, after only 2 months, will become old and then die. So do reeds, they just live for a few months. Lotuses and water lilies live only for 2 or 3 months. In the summer, they bloom and then die. It's their lifespan. So do you agree that lifespan varies among species, kinds, and breeds? About lifespan, there exist general and specific ones, but each individual of the species has a specific lifespan. Have you got this? That is about lifespan. For example, each person in this life is like an oil lamp. Each lamp has a wick, which is a metaphor for our lifespan. The flame is our life, and the wick is our lifespan. A small oil lamp has a short wick, while big float lamps, mantle lanterns, or hurricane lamps have longer wicks. They are different. However, lamps of the same type also have different wicks. Not all wicks are long. During manufacturing, sometimes wicks are unequally cut. So, some are short, some are long. Similarly, humans share an average lifespan, and each person has a particular lifespan. Do you understand this point about lifespan? Here, Nagasena talked about whom Paritta Sutras can protect. There are people who recite Paritta Sutras with full faith and whose lifespans still last. Otherwise, Paritta Sutras can't protect them. For example, it is impossible that a dying 99-year-old man can be cured thanks to reciting these sutras. An end-stage cancer patient with shortness of breath can't recover by reciting these sutras. You should understand that. His lifespan must still last. For example, if young healthy people who suddenly catch COVID-19 or suffer from diseases know how to practice the Dharma, they can recover. Dear Great Assembly, it can be said that Paritta Sutras can protect people whose lifespans still last, not those whose lifespans have run out. The Parittas can help us escape sudden deaths. In Buddhism, such deaths are called untimely death. An untimely death means one dies when their lifespan hasn't come to an end. Dear Great Assembly, there are a lot of untimely deaths. As humans, we are all born from the womb. Maybe our places of birth are a bit different. In the hospital, at home, even on the road, or in the field, for example. But everyone comes from their mother's womb. However, causes of death vary among people, and there are many causes of death. A natural death means a death occurring when lifespan has run out. It is the most wanted death, dying from natural causes such as old age or age-related diseases, is called dying at the right time. Today, untimely death is commonplace, dear Great Assembly. What are the causes of untimely death? Firstly, It is death due to illness. So what are the causes of death from illness? Some may die of severe diseases, or people die of diseases because they don't have sufficient blessings to visit the right doctor or get right treatment. Some sick people also die because they have right treatment but don't obey the instructions. Or consulting good doctors but being prescribed the wrong medicine also results in death. Dear Great Assembly, those are untimely deaths. Consulting good doctors but getting the wrong prescription may cause death. It is called needless death. So, death due to diseases is the first cause. Of course, today, many people die of diseases. And what are other causes of death? Some have to die because they have committed a crime which carries the death sentence under national legislation. This is called being put to death. This is also untimely death. Some may live for a few more dozen years, but due to committing a crime, they receive capital punishment from the king or national legislation. Then they have to die, dear Great Assembly. They are deprived of their lives, though their lifespan still lasts. What else can cause death? Suicide. For some reason, one feels so tired of life that he commits suicide. That's when one deprives himself of his life, although his lifespan hasn't run out yet. Nowadays, suicide is so common, dear Great Assembly. In modern society, many people commit suicide. Another common cause of death is accidents. Deaths from accidents are also called untimely deaths. What are accidents? Road traffic accidents, drowning, fire, plane crash, landslide, falling tree, tunnel collapse, or falling into sinkholes, and so on. Some die of electric shock, do you see? Many people die of accidents in the workplace. Deaths from earthquakes, tsunamis, and volcanoes. Countless deaths are due to accidents. Do you see? Numerous. Some even die of vicious animal attack. For example, snakes and tigers. And what's more, food poisoning, being poisoned on purpose, unhealthy environments, living in toxic environments, and drinking poisonous water also can cause us to die. Some may die in war. Now it is also terrible. You see, wars still happen constantly in many countries, and so many people die in war. This is caused by humans ourselves. Some die of debauchery. They lose their vitality to demons through extreme dissipation, drunkenness, or addiction. This kind of death results from debauchery. Some may die due to spells or black magic. Medicine Buddha Sutra says there are people who die from charms, spells, black magic, or curses. We may die of being put on a curse. Some may die because ghosts and non-humans take their lives. It's wrong to say that there are no ghosts. Then what is another reason for death? Some die of overwork. And what's more? Deaths from hunger, thirst, cold, or heat. Do you see? Too many types of death to list. Those are also untimely deaths. A death occurring when lifespan hasn't run out yet is called an untimely death. Here, Nagasena says, Paritta Sutras can protect those whose lifespan still lasts only if they have faith, practice, and observe the Dharma. The sutras can protect those whose lifespans have run out. When their lifespans have run out, there is no way to help. In our life, we all expect to live happily and die peacefully. But how can we achieve this? Nagasena said that the Paritas have the power of protection. King Milinda then asked, I temporarily believe what you say, Venerable Sir. Nagasena replied, O King, indeed, those who have faith in the three jewels, the power of the Paritas, and the virtues of the Paritas and wholeheartedly recite can eliminate diseases, calamities, and tribulations. Also, they have the blessing power to protect practitioners and help them avoid the snare of death. That's for sure. You see, Nagasena is an Arhat. He asserted to King Milinda that those who have such full faith can be protected against calamities by the Paritas. Their lifespans can be preserved. Then the king said, Venerable, please give me some evidence. Nagasena took an example. O king, as in the city of Vesali, Venerable Ananda and 500 bhikshus walked three times around the city and recited the Paritas the whole night. All devas in many realms rejoiced. Then all the fears of the epidemic and non-humans of Vesali citizens ended. This is a very particular sutra in Buddhist scriptures. And what's more, Nagasena continued, Holy monks and eminent monks often say that if one diligently recites the Paritas, venomous snakes will silently go away. They won't dare to bite anymore. A thief who is raising a stick to attack, hearing the Paritas, has to gently put his hands down. An elephant on heat that wants to trample humans, hearing the Paritas, will suddenly calm down and gently go away. Strong flames used to burn the one who is reciting the Paritas, fail to harm him. Poison can't harm him either. Bhikshu Nagasena asserted to King Milinda so, venomous snakes, fierce elephants, even thieves or poison can't harm the person who recites the Paritas. You can see how great the power of protection of the Paritas is. O King, there was a case that a peacock was determined to chant the Paritas to protect his life. A hunter patiently tried to trap the peacock many times for years, but failed to catch him. A peacock knows how to chant the sutra. So strange. Likewise, many parrots can sing, so that a peacock can chant the sutra is not impossible. We can believe this, right? A parrot can sing and talk like humans. But when the peacock was sick about a female peacock he loved, forgetting to chant the sutra, he was trapped by the hunter that very day. You see, Nagasena said very clearly, this peacock loved a female peacock. He was mooning over the female peacock that he forgot to recite the Paritas. That very day, he missed reciting, and he was caught by the hunter. It means he was no longer protected. Nagasena gave very specific examples, which were recorded in Buddhist scriptures, to talk about the power of protection of Paritta Sutras. O King, the Paritas, like food, can support some people and can't support some others. Some people can't be protected by the Paritas for the following three reasons. Let's listen to the reasons why the Paritas can't protect some people and who they are. We should try not to become any of these three kinds of people. The first is the person who is obstructed by his evil karma. People with very evil karma are obstructed. Do you see? Your own evil karma. The Buddha also said that even he couldn't change the fixed karma of sentient beings. Even Maudgalyayana was foremost in terms of supernatural powers among the Buddha's disciples. The Buddha couldn't save him because it was his fixed karma.
không thể cứu nổi vì định nghiệp thôi.
Mount Kalyayana was hacked to pieces by robbers. It was fixed karma. So people with severely bad karma can't be protected by Paritta Sutras. So we have to cultivate ourselves to avoid bad karma. We don't know if we created any bad karma in our past life, but in this current life, we should try to cultivate ourselves. The second are those with many afflictions in mind. Those whose minds are filled with so many afflictions or who have physical and mental disorder can't be protected. Of course, those with too many afflictions can't recite the sutras, Dear Great Assembly. People whose minds are chaotic and filled with too many afflictions can't be protected by the sutras either. Those who recite the sutras with a wandering mind full of afflictions can be protected. The third are people who do not have faith and patience and do not stay determined to recite. They just parrot the sutras. This point is very important. A person who recites the Paritas without faith is like a child forced by his parents to recite the sutras without faith. Or he may even profane the sutras. Oh, reciting the sutras is a waste of time and effort. How can he be protected? How can he attract the power of protection? Right? So people reciting the sutras must have faith. I will talk about faith later. People without perseverance and practice are those who neither believe nor practice the teachings in the sutras. They don't generate any good deeds. They just recite like a parrot. They can't attract the power of protection. These are three major obstacles to the power of protection of Paritta Sutras, O King. Apart from these three cases, the Paritas can take effect to protect us. That is the truth. Dear Great Assembly, the power of Paritta Sutras is enormous. So the Buddha said that the Paritas can protect us from the snare of death if we have faith and our lifespan still lasts. We can even escape death. Many Buddhists share with me their true experiences. They practice and recite sutras, then they truly escape calamities. They have very deep faith. Dear Great Assembly, what about faith? The Buddha taught, faith is the mother of all virtues and merit. Faith nurtures all virtues and merit. Faith is the mother of all virtues and merit. So what kind of faith should it be here? It should be the right faith, not the wrong faith. We are talking about right faith. Wrong faith lessens our blessings. So what does it mean to be a person having the right faith in Buddhism? What should we believe in? We believe in the Buddha, the Dharma, the Sangha, the law of cause and effect, karma, reincarnation, the cycle of birth and death, the Four Noble Truths, and the Eightfold Noble Path that the Buddha taught. People with those kinds of faith are more or less considered to have the right faith. What does it mean to believe in the Buddha? First, we believe in the Buddha. We believe that the Buddha was a real person, a real historical figure. He achieved the supreme enlightenment. He was the life-saver who had a compassionate mind and desire to save all sentient beings. He was truly an excellent great man. The Buddha was not a fictional character who was created by humans. The Buddha was a real character. Although the Buddha entered Nirvana, his Dharma body is eternal and imperishable. He left his physical body, but his Dharma body stays forever, and his mind still shines throughout the Dharma realm. We must believe so. His compassion doesn't reduce and is imperishable. His compassion or his love for sentient beings isn't lost. That is a very special thing. We have to believe that, firmly believe that. And what else? To believe in the Dharma is to believe that the Buddha's teachings are the truth and the righteous way that leads us to the end of suffering and releases us from all suffering. Certainly, the Dharma was spoken from the truth. The Buddha was the one who attained the truth and penetrated the truth. So what he spoke all came from the truth. It is forever true. It's never wrong. Next, it is to believe in the Sangha. The essence of a Sangha is purity and nobility. A true Sangha really has the power of rescue. The Sangha is also a highly noble field of blessings in the world from which sentient beings can cultivate blessings. We believe in the laws of cause and effect, that there is cause and there is its effect. As I analyzed before, the coronavirus is the karma, the retribution of humanity. It didn't happen without reason. In this Dharma realm, nothing is born without reason. Everything has their causes, and so does the coronavirus. This virus was born when causes and conditions were fully assembled. It was humanity's bad karma that caused this virus to appear. So all of humanity must pay the price and suffer the consequences. Next, we believe in the existence of the cycle of birth and death, right? It is real. It can't be denied that there exists the cycle of birth and death. We are the disciples of the Buddha, so we firmly believe this. There are six paths of reincarnation and six realms, unlike statements of some people. There are no hell, no hungry ghosts, no demons, no devas, and no sages. There is only the realm of humans and animals. No, that is not true. Because we are ordinary people, we can't see everything with our naked eyes. Although we can't see those invisible realms, we should not deny it. We should believe in the words of the Buddha and the sages. Their vision is broader than ours. Our vision is just within 10 kilometers. We cannot thoroughly see everything. It is not right if we just believe in what we can see with our eyes and hear with our ears. Therefore, people say, we should believe in the sages' teachings. We believe in the Four Noble Truths and the Eightfold Noble Path, which is the path leading us to the end of suffering. That is the right faith, dear Great Assembly. How should our faith be? Here, Paritta Sutras say that we must have full faith. Having full faith means we have strong, firm, and pure belief. Buddhist sutras often mention the phrase pure faith. It means the pure faith inside us, dear Great Assembly. Our belief makes our mind bright and firm. If our mind is dark and we feel confused and deluded, we have no faith. When our mind is dark, we don't have faith. We even lose faith. When our mind is clear, naturally our faith is very stable, and sometimes faith itself helps us purify our mind. Therefore, faith is also like an alum block put in a jar of dirty water. It will purify the water. We should put our faith in the three jewels. Firm belief helps our mind become pure. We think of the Buddha, the Bodhisattvas, and the sages. Our mind will become clearer, and our faith will be stronger. Here, we are talking about strong faith, not about a kind of weak and superficial faith. Do you understand? Our faith is weak and superficial sometimes, believing something today, but suspecting it tomorrow. You may often say you have strong faith, but when bad things happen, you turn to disbelieving in the Buddha, in the three jewels, and in the law of cause and effect. Seeing bad people who still enjoy their lives, you may say, oh, there is no such thing called the law of cause and effect. And when seeing benevolent people who suffer a lot, you say, oh, so there is no cause and effect. You may deny it, then you lose your faith. That is how our belief tends to be. Or you may believe that there are no ghosts, no demons, no sages, and no divinities. Dear Great Assembly, there is a story that Duratamamara went into Venerable Mount Galiayana's belly and entered his intestines. It swirled his intestines. Though he had the foremost supernatural powers among all bhikshus, Duratamamara could enter and swirl around his belly. He heard a strange sound in his belly, then he gave thorough attention to himself and recognized Duratamamara. He said, "Come out, I can see you. You know what? I was your uncle in a previous life. You are just my descendant." Because Venerable Mount Galiayana also had a life as a Mara, and this Duratamamara in that life was his nephew. Then Venerable Mount Galiayana called the Mara out. Duratamamara was detected, so he had to come out. So we cannot say there are no ghosts and demons. When sitting in meditation, Venerable Sariputra was beaten over the head by a demon with great power. At that time, he was entering concentration. Venerable Mount Galiayana said that the power of that hit could turn Mount Sumeru into dust. But when Venerable Sariputra exited meditation, he just found out that his head ached a little bit, and he wondered why his head ached. Venerable Mount Galiayana then said, "A moment ago, there was a demon with great power passing by. It hit your head. With the force of that hit, even Mount Sumeru could crumble into dust. But since Venerable Sariputra entered into meditation, the power of concentration protected him from that hit. It is terrible, isn't it? So why do some people say there are no demons? In Buddhist Sutra system, there is a collection called Pitavatu, which features many stories of hungry ghosts, all kinds of ghosts. Therefore, we should believe in the existence of ghosts. In the sutra we are studying, Venerable Nagasena said, "Those who chant the Paritas must have full faith, practice, and observe the sutra. First of all, they must have faith. Then they must practice. They need to patiently practice the Buddha's teachings. If they take refuge in the three jewels and believe in the three jewels, they will certainly be protected by the protective power of Paritta Sutras." It is very obvious. Dear Great Assembly, through the analysis above, we can see that the prayer and recitation of Ratana Sutra of monks, nuns, and lay Buddhists in the hope of overcoming this pandemic is a practical action according to the Buddhist sutras.
Đối chiếu với kinh điển của Phật là một việc làm hết sức thiết thực.
If we want that we, as well as our relatives, our friends, our society, our country, and the whole world, will overcome this pandemic, we should practice the Dharma, pray and recite Paritta Sutras with truly firm faith in the three jewels.
Hãy tụng trì kinh này và với đức tin thật là kiên cố nơi tam bảo. Đức tin kiên cố.
You know, the compassionate mind of the Buddhas and Bodhisattvas spreads everywhere and never diminishes.
Không bao giờ vơi giảm cả. Nhưng
but our prayer only works as long as there are enough causes and conditions. As I usually say, without fully assembled causes and conditions, there will be no effect. Every occurrence needs fully assembled causes and conditions. The sun shines everywhere, and in some places, people can make a fire from sunlight. For example, we have a magnifying glass and dry grass or tinder. We can make a fire with a magnifying glass, just with a glass and some tinder under the sunlight. That is an example of fully assembled causes and conditions. Anyone has ever used the magnifying glass to make a fire? I have. Although the sun keeps shining, without the magnifying glass and tinder, we cannot make a fire. That is called full causes and conditions. The sun always shines, but only where causes and conditions are fully assembled will fire be created. The moon lights up the sky. However, the moon can only reflect off the water surface, not the ground. That means when conditions are adequate, the moon will reflect. Similarly, the compassion of the Buddhas and Bodhisattvas spreads throughout the Dharma realm, but whoever collects enough causes and conditions will attract their compassion and receive protection from the Buddhas. Although the Buddha's protection is impartial, there must be enough causes and conditions, otherwise we cannot receive their protection. There are three things possible and impossible to a Buddha. What are three things impossible? First, a Buddha cannot save all sentient beings. Second, a Buddha cannot immediately change fixed karma of sentient beings. Third, a Buddha cannot save people with no connection with him. Please remember that. Those are the three things a Buddha cannot do. So that explains. So, through my explanation, I really hope that all monks, nuns, and lay Buddhists of our pagoda, with the mind of the Buddha's disciples, confronting this catastrophic pandemic, will develop your bodhi-mind and compassion towards humanity, regardless of race and religion. We will send love to all. And with our own efforts, let's practice the Dharma, pray and recite Ratana Sutra with firm faith to dedicate the merit to everyone, so that we will overcome this pandemic soon. That is my expectation and message to all the monks, nuns, and lay Buddhists. Besides, each of us should encourage our relatives and friends to take refuge in the three jewels, because it means we are forming a connection with the three jewels, Buddhism and the Buddha Dharma. Taking refuge in the three jewels is also a practice of forming a connection to the three jewels. To take refuge means to return, to rely on, which is a practice of forming a connection to the three jewels. We encourage our family members, our friends, and everyone we know to take refuge in the three jewels. We give them opportunities to learn the Dharma so that they can understand the Dharma and develop firm faith in the three jewels. Because those who take refuge in the three jewels without learning the Dharma can't have faith. So we should help people take refuge in the three jewels, as well as guide them through learning the Dharma, so that everyone can develop their faith and benefit from the three jewels. That is what I really want. Now I want to recap the topic of the Dharma talk today, praying and chanting Ratana Sutra with complete faith to overcome the COVID-19 pandemic. We have understood our causes, conditions, and our karma. We must cultivate ourselves and practice the Buddha's teachings. Especially, we should practice and recite Ratana Sutra, as well as increase our faith, so that each of us will be able to transform karma. Because only when we transform karma can we be protected. When we are protected, it means that we have transformed our bad karma. And when we spread this energy to the community, the society, and the whole of humanity, everyone can gain blessings from our good mind to a certain extent. May humanity overcome this pandemic soon. And may everyone have a good connection with the three jewels. That is the wish I want to send to you all. May you all be safe and overcome this pandemic peacefully. Namo Shakyamuni Buddha. Now please join your hands to dedicate the merit.
Nguyện đem công đức này hướng về
khắp tất cả ơi đệ tử và chúng sinh đều chọn thành Phật đạo.